Hi, good afternoon. I'm Karen Young from Hays, and I'm delighted to welcome you all to this webinar, which I hope will help you consider and plan your career journey in accountancy. Thank you all for attending. Thank you also for completing some of the polling questions so we can see how many of you have been planning your career steps so far and what general career direction you're hoping to take. Bit of housekeeping, please do use the Q&A function, which should be on your screen for any questions you want to ask as we go along, and we'll try and take as many of these as we can at the close of the webinar. By way of brief introduction, I've worked at Hays for over 20 years, recruiting from entry-level finance posts to finance director and CFO appointments, and I'm responsible for our accountancy and finance recruitment business across the UK at Hays. We're a global recruiter providing recruitment support to hundreds of businesses. And to put things in context, last year we secured permanent positions for over 60,000 people around the world and placed over 250,000 people into temporary work. Here in the UK, within the finance world, we secure a job for a finance professional round about every 10 minutes in the UK. So a number of people should be getting job offers as we conduct this webinar today. We also produce a large number of reports and guides for accountancy and finance employees. These include our DNA series, DNA of a finance director, DNA of a partner, DNA of a head of treasury, as well as the accountancy and finance skill capability gap report and our Hays annual salary and recruiting trends guide. I'm delighted today to be joined by Sally Percy, a leading business and finance journalist. Sally has written for The Telegraph, The Times, Accountancy and Business Magazine, and many more accountancy and finance industry publications. She is also the author of the new book, Reach the Top, An Ambitious Accountant's Guide to Career Success, which features exclusive interviews with CFOs of FTSE 100 and Fortune 500 companies. The book offers true insight into what it takes to be successful in a competitive environment. And as an exclusive offer to you today, as part of the official launch of the new book, we're delighted to announce we will be providing a 30% discount code at the end of the presentation, should you wish to order the book, so stay tuned. I'd like to first begin by discussing why career progression is so important. It's a subject matter that I'm very passionate about. The potential for career progression in your job is absolutely vital for your professional satisfaction. Not knowing whether your career is moving in the right direction or feeling uncertain about what steps to take in order to reach your long-term goals can leave you feeling like you've got no direction. And many people have expressed to us that over the last 12 months of pretty much constant political turbulence, I don't think anyone could argue that, they are increasingly concerned about their career progression and professional futures. And this was brought home to me, particularly by the findings from our recent 2017 UK Salary and Recruiting Trends Guide. For those of you who maybe are unfamiliar with it, our annual guide covers the salaries and trends for a vast number of professions, sectors and regions, obviously including accountancy and finance. And this year, almost 17,000 people in the UK responded to our survey, which was carried out in the summer of 2016. You can find the salary online at hays.co.uk/salary-checker. For the first time, we also conducted another survey of over 2,200 responses in September for obvious reasons to see if anything had changed following the EU referendum. And I think for me, one of the most interesting findings did relate to career progression. What you can see in front of you was the answer to the question when our survey respondents were asked whether they believed there was scope for career progression within their organizations. We noticed a clear trend. Firstly, the number of employees who believed there were opportunities for career development had dropped from last year's. And secondly, after the EU referendum, confidence in an employee's organization's ability to offer adequate career progression opportunities dropped again, as you can see, from 43% to 33%, indicating that accountancy and finance professionals appear to be more concerned than ever about the opportunities for progression available to them. In fact, of the 6 out of 10 accountancy and finance employees who said they would potentially consider moving jobs in 2017, 30% stated this was due to a lack of future opportunities, which was the top reason for leaving a job actually cited in the survey. It may well be the case that employers are not effectively promoting progression pathways to us. However, I would say that we have to remember career progression is not merely the domain of managers and directors and senior staff. You shouldn't be a passive recipient in your career progression. Rather, you must take some responsibility for your own career path. And this should always start with at least thinking about where you're heading, so your journey ahead, so to speak. And then you can proactively discuss this upwards with your manager, and it will help you to get onto the right path. Being proactive with regard to your own progression will empower you to make challenging, but I would say rewarding career decisions. This could be going for an internal promotion, spearheading a new division, switching to a new company, maybe even a new industry altogether. And for those of you who are in the process of completing or maybe have just completed your accountancy qualifications, for whom this webinar is primarily aimed at, building a career plan now will help you determine what professional path to follow and ensure that in 2, 5, or 10 years, you are happy with the direction your career is progressing in. So the key question is, what is career planning? And put simply, I describe it as a continuous process and a personal process of getting yourself and your career organized, making your career ideas and goals achievable, and knowing what you need to do to achieve them. It's something you should consider in your current job and something that every year you look at after that. And it's never more important than at the early stages of your professional life. For many of you, during the run-up to your professional accountancy exams, completing your studies and qualification will have consumed your attention, and rightly so. However, once these exams are behind you, it's time to know what options are available to you. So let's take a look at the four-step plan. The good news is there's a tried and tested and actually very simple method of approaching career planning. There are four main steps. First, remember that this is all about you. And you have control, but you do need the time to think and to make the time to think. Secondly, because you're already investing in a financial career at this stage, use your ability to research and analyze. It should be a skill you already have, and use it to help you to determine the options available to you to do the research. Thirdly, deciding what steps you need to take to accomplish your goal or goals. And then finally, The piece about taking action, don't sit on the fence once you've got to step three. It can be easy to get to a planning stage, but you do have to sometimes take that leap of faith and make yourself responsible for actually making it happen. So let's take a look at these steps in a little bit more detail. The first step involves considering what you want out of a job and what you have to offer. You need to be able to identify your skills and do a simple but effective SWOT analysis, looking at your strengths, your weaknesses, and what the opportunities and maybe threats might be. For example, if you decide you definitely want to be a future leader of people in whatever industry but haven't had experience of managing people yet, then approach it with some small steps. Ensure that you're proactive. For example, offer to supervise the next temp that your department takes on, or volunteer to support your manager with taking on some coaching work with another member of staff or team on a topic you feel expert on or feel really comfortable with, or take a project lead, and this will help you build a skills portfolio. Visualizing the future and where you want to be both in work and in life at various milestones is also important at this stage. The next phase of career planning is researching your options. We're in a world where we are better connected than ever before. It is a lot easier to career plan in 2017 than it was when I started my career in accountancy and finance recruitment in 1996. You can search on job titles online. You can find out how frequently the jobs that interest you come to the market, what sort of salaries they offer, whether they're predominant in a particular geographical location, what their work-life balance might look like, which recruitment consultancies are experts in your market. And by reading those job and person descriptions that are readily available online all around the world, you should also be able to get a view of what qualifications are needed, what skills, what competencies, what you need to be able to do the job that you want so you can move into this look at your overall plan and start to plan your moves, not just the next job, but two or three ahead so you can see what route you need to take. That said, whilst we're in a digital age, you shouldn't lose sight of the value that can be gained from speaking with people, such as other people you work with, people you might have studied with, and indeed mentors, and asking how they got to where they are in their career and what advice they can offer you. If someone's job at work intrigues you, ask to have a chat with them. It's usually human nature to help. You just have to remember to ask. And you're already on the right track on steps one and two of this by attending this webinar, especially if this is just the start of you thinking about you and beginning to research your options. So what exactly are some of the career options available to part in newly qualified accountancy and finance professionals such as yourselves? What do the jobs involve and what can they offer you in terms of longer-term career progression? Let's take a look at a few. The good news is that the contribution that you make to an organization has never been so highly valued. The CEOs, the CFOs, the heads of HR who regularly recruit finance professionals through us here at Hays always tell us the priority for them at whatever level is to identify finance professionals who can apply technical expertise, business awareness or commercial nous, as I like to say, and their communication skills to a range of tasks and responsibilities. And the options open to you are therefore many, they're varied, and they're exciting. But this in itself, the abundance of opportunities, lends its own challenges, namely deciding upon what career path to take, and also critically, at what time. Firstly, let's look at the private sector, commerce and industry, if you like. You might be wondering how the work you would carry out in small to medium-sized enterprises or medium-sized businesses would contrast to what you would expect in large companies and multinationals. Within larger multinational companies, finance functions enjoy significant influence, providing CEOs, CFOs, the rest of the C-suite, board executives, with data-driven intelligence to make strategic decisions. A career in a blue-chip company can provide clear career direction. It can provide the opportunity to develop your networks, plot your career path, give you exposure to senior management and industry leaders, and the chance to develop your role and reputation as a trusted business partner. There are more opportunities sometimes to move internally within business units. And in the largest organizations, many of these types of jobs could also include an international remit, providing opportunities for travel or overseas secondments or even longer-term relocations. If you're an agile thinker, you're very proactive, you're hands-on, you count yourself probably as something of an entrepreneur, you might enjoy a key finance role in a growing SME or perhaps a smaller AIM-listed business. Many successful and fast-growing startups and small businesses are run by energetic and ambitious and passionate entrepreneurs who value like-minded professionals in their finance function. This can give you a good overview of the demands of growing a business, internal influence, genuine decision-making opportunities, the opportunity to see your ideas and your recommendations acted on swiftly and decisively. And in some SMEs, you may get a view of broader business decisions faster than in a multinational. Whether you're interested in working in an SME or a large corporate multinational, a career in private sector, commerce and industry is a good way to grow your experiences and achieve your long-term ambitions if you're thinking you might want to become a future finance director. I would just put at this point, it's really important to gain experience here in both profit and loss and balance sheet focused jobs if finance director is your ultimate goal. If you've previously worked in external audit or you're currently working in external audit, you might be thinking you want to move away from auditing. I've heard that quite frequently over the years. But whilst obviously there's some shared characteristics, as you will know, external and internal audit are very different roles. A role in internal audit in a multinational big company is, in my view, far too underrated sometimes by finance professionals looking to make that first move into the commercial sector. And if you look at many of the current CFOs and finance directors of FTSE-listed businesses, Fortune 500 companies, many of them cut their teeth in audit roles in industry and all the exposure to business and projects that you can gain from doing this. Being frank, it's a direct route into a major blue chip business. It's a bridging role, but it is an opportunity to make your route in. It's not a box ticking exercise these days, if it ever was. Internal auditors are proactive, consultative business partners who can contribute to the ongoing success of a business and really help to instigate change and make sure that recommendations are seen through. There's opportunities then in the future to move into more mainstream finance roles, should you wish, business-facing, strategic roles, more senior positions within the internal audit function. It enables you to consider jobs within the wider fields of risk and compliance, and indeed in a FTSE business, there's both financial and professional reward to holding the position of Director of Audit, Risk and Compliance. So working within internal audit can open doors, and there can be really exciting opportunities to further progress your career. And of course, an increasing focus on governance, cyber risk, digitalization, disruption means that areas like internal audit and risk and compliance is held in high regard. For many newly qualified professionals, working as an accountant in the city is still an ideal career destination. The competition remains fierce for work in the investment, the retail and the boutique banks, in asset management companies, indeed in insurers and life companies, private equity firms, venture capital houses, hedge funds. But of course, there are other opportunities to work in the financial services sector these days outside of London and the city, in locations such as Leeds or Manchester, amongst other places. The bar for working in these environments is often set high, and in order to truly thrive, you will need exemplary records in your academic and professional exams, your industry knowledge, and to gain that credibility with your senior colleagues and clients. The benefits working in the city and within financial services are plenty, and they do extend beyond the pay. If a stronger work-life balance appeals to you, perhaps considering a career in retail banking versus investment banking might suit, does offer good professional development in terms of its career path. And as a newly qualified in retail banking, you'd be exposed to senior stakeholders working on challenging projects and being given responsibility and autonomy. It's a highly commercial, consumer-facing career, good opportunities to move within different business lines. Investment banking is still one of the most sought-after career paths in the city. Competitive business nature, excellent compensation structure, highly meritocratic professional environment, as you'll know. Organisations within these competitive institutions cater to people who are looking for a challenging, probably international career, people who enjoy the complex nature of investment banking products. You should be confident operating in a really fast-paced, high-performance office culture. And finally, if you like a vibrant culture with good learning opportunities, investment management could be for you. So this encompasses hedge funds, private equity firms, private wealth managers, VCs, venture capitalists, custodians, administrators, and they offer professional management of securities and other assets in order to achieve goals set by investors. The services are similar to those offered by investment banks, but there is a slightly different culture and sometimes better work balance on the whole. Niche investment houses are often more intimate operation, removed from the corporate behaviours of the big banking institutions, widely considered to be fantastic places to learn the true operations of financial markets, get the complexities of financial products, and benefit from an excellent workplace culture. And finally, within the financial services piece. As we've just mentioned, investment banking is undoubtedly viewed by many business graduates as the career destination of choice, and as a result, it's one of the most competitive and perhaps elite recruitment markets in the world, still in 2017. Excellent pay, bonus potential in front office, partly the reason why, and when you consider and combine the income possibilities with the career prospects, it's no surprise that a lot of ACA qualified professionals are eager in particular to pursue a career in this area. Getting in the foot in the door, strong academic results, great personal credentials, strong exam results from throughout your academic life. And if your long-term goal is to be a corporate financier or investment banker, an entry-level job in front office is where you should be. It's demanding, it needs high levels of drive and achievement, but the rewards are many, and it's obviously the thrill of operating in a very influential area. Career development, of course, is not limited to the banking world and private sector business. Professional services is big industry in the UK and around the world, and indeed, by sector alone, is one of our busiest areas for finance recruitment each month in the UK. Lots of career choices if you're currently in a big four or a large firm, opportunity to specialise, and whether that's more traditional routes, corporate finance, corporate recovery, tax. We'll cover tax shortly in its own right. My advice here, if you are recently qualified or approaching qualification, is don't feel too much pressure to leave a big four firm immediately that your exam results are through. One of the most frequently asked questions I've been asked throughout my career is, how quickly do I need to move in order not to jeopardise my career choices in the future? Quite simply, you have got a bit of time. Some people know what direction they want to head in, and they make pretty swift and sure decisions, and that's fine for them. But many of you may just not know yet. Take your time, do your research, and don't be hurried by anyone. A year or two or more of gaining different experiences, secondments, international experience, specialisation in a big four firm will do you as much good as a move into a different sector that you may be not sure about. And you may just decide in that time that your route is to consultancy. You could think you're going to advise on cyber risk, for example, becoming an expert in your field, mapping out your route to director or partner. Thinking about options in different size firms, then many mid-tier and independent firms are tasked with challenging assignments outside of the traditional service offerings. So if you want to build your career outside the big four, it's worth considering the niche boutique firms. Whilst boutique firms can be by definition small, many of the most successful have been set up by entrepreneurial finance professionals who've had large firm training, and it does allow employees to develop commerciality and business acumen. You might specialize in business lines including corporate finance, corporate recovery, to further build your technical and your client-facing skills, and there's often a very clear career path. It also allows you to establish those strong working relationships with very competent colleagues and experts across a number of different financial disciplines. If you decide you do want to stay within the profession but outside of the Big Four, then switching to a different firm might provide you with those substantial assignments you need to enhance your career. And as promised, just having a look at taxation, whether you work in professional services or commerce and industry, tax work in today's business world calls for really powerful analytical skills, lateral thinking, a problem-solving mindset. A career in tax will definitely be varied. It will present a lot of opportunities to develop your advisory, your consultative skills whilst you're working with senior stakeholders. You'll get experience advising clients on tax legislation, knowledge of ever-changing tax laws, complicated legislation. And you'll also have pretty clear career progression. As seniority increases, tax professionals specialize in specific areas such as corporate or national insurance or personal tax. And increasingly, the in-house tax roles offer international remits, opportunities to learn about managing tax in different jurisdictions around the world, and all the technical and intellectual challenges that this can bring with it. We operate our businesses in an increasingly global world, increasingly complicated political and economic backdrops, and there's no doubt that to be an expert in the field will be rewarding and of immense added value to the organisation you work for. Changing world out there, and it's not often that there's not a tax story in the news and in the media these days. And finally, Treasury. A career in Treasury, opportunity to work at the heart of an organisation, providing valuable support to all the key functions. This has developed at the senior level into a really corporate role. You'd be looking at financial and risk management, liquidity management, funding, insurance, investor relations, global supply chain, pricing. You'll be working with Treasury teams, looking at bank administration, data analysis, cash forecasting, or undertaking a technical Treasury reporting role. The profession offers a wide variety of consultancy type roles within the Big Four and smaller advisory firms, where you'll get exposure to some of the largest companies in the UK, working with finance directors and CFOs of businesses in change. I'd also say the door to the CFO or Group FD's office is far more open to the Group Treasurer than it ever has been. Having a Treasury function used to be the domain of the FTSE 100 in the 90s and the 2000s. We've definitely seen that change here at Hays, with organisations in the last year or two as small as, say, 40 million annual turnover, recruiting a first specific Treasury person to help them make the most out of their cash. So, quite simply, more opportunities than ever before. And last but not least, finance professionals continue to enjoy really key roles in public services and not-for-profit organisations, influencing decisions that impact on service delivery on a massive scale, social objective strategies, regardless of the economic climate. And by working within public services or a not-for-profit, you'll benefit from usually really first-class resources and often state-of-the-art systems and technologies, exciting project work, which includes input on strategies that are going to determine how really substantial budgets should be invested. I think you should consider this career path if you will gain satisfaction from the knowledge that the work you're carrying out will contribute either directly or indirectly to the lives of the wider society. But there's also a proactive, supportive approach to training and learning. And I do also think that people who build their career in public services and not-for-profit are often involved at an earlier stage in their career in strategic thinking and planning. And of course, like the private sector, you can choose large or small, from the largeness of the NHS to a small charity. The choice is there. So now let's just spend a couple of minutes to look at the final two steps of creating a career plan, how to put your findings into action. The third step is about making plans. So having thought about you, gone away to do more research, it's time to pull together an action plan to achieve your goals. You may decide that you really want to go off and study a specific qualification in addition to your ICAW. CEMA or ACCA qualification, could be tax or treasury, for example. These are the things you need to think about. You might need to learn French if you're going to go on an international secondment. How are you going to make it happen and what steps do you need to take today? The other questions it's helpful to consider are up in front of you, and I'd urge you again to think, who are the people who could help me get there? Ask about mentoring possibilities in your current organisation if you can. And If there's not a formal structured mentoring program, find an informal one. I'm really happy to chat to people outside of the webinar on this. You can find me on LinkedIn. My details will be there at the end about how to approach it. But I do believe a mentor, and indeed in future a sponsor in your future career, can be really beneficial for all of you. And I'm not sure, but Sally may touch briefly on that in a little while. Final bit before I hand over to Sally is the taking action, step four. This involves reflecting back to the thinking about you section, reflecting on your skills, your knowledge, your experience, and putting your plans into action by presenting yourself effectively on paper, and more importantly, in person. It may seem the simplest, but I think actually for most people it's often the hardest because you've got to put your money where your mouth is. And the best piece of advice here is take action, put your plan in place, and be proactive about climbing that career ladder. But remember, the best laid plans of mice and men, the fact of the matter is most carefully prepared plans can sometimes go wrong. It's a good thing to have your plan, but remember the best plans can be flexed and adapted. So while there's always a plan A, be ready to put plan B into place too. Keep your plan agile, keep it up to date, revisit it not every 5 years, but indeed every few months. It's a bit like keeping your CV up to date. It should be a living, working document like your career plan. And I'll just close with a comment made to me pretty recently by one of my connections from about 15 years ago. At the time I met him, he was an undergraduate working for free in his year one of his degree at a firm of chartered accountants to gain good experience. And he said to me, the meeting we had at that time was invaluable because it was independent, impartial advice. And he's often gone back to that along his journey from that first year of his degree right through to now operating as a CFO. So that people bit again, find someone you trust and reach out to them. An independent person can offer a really thorough and a long-term approach to your career guidance. If you'd like to learn more about any of these career options, we do have a guide called Your Journey Ahead, which can help you to navigate your next steps. And the details are on the screen in front of you. You can go to hays.co.uk/journey-ahead to get started. And now I will hand you over with great pleasure to Sally Percy, author of her new book, Reach the Top, An Ambitious Accountant's Guide to Career Success. Over to you, Sally.
Thank you very much for that introduction, Karen, and hello, everybody. As Karen said, I'm a business and finance journalist, and I used to edit Accountancy magazine and also the Treasurer. And I've written for The Times, The Telegraph, and a number of other financial publications. And I've also done quite a lot of writing work for corporate clients, including Hays and EY, KPMG, and PwC. I'm here today to talk to you about my new book, which Karen mentioned, Reach the Top in Financing, Business Accountant's Guide to Success, which has just been published by Bloomsbury. And that features case studies, exclusive interviews with FTSE 100 finance directors, Fortune 500 CFOs, and also senior leaders from accountancy firms. So I've got some details on how to buy the book at a discount, and I'll share them with you at the end of my presentation. So what are we going to cover today? Today we're actually going to look at some of the key points that came out from my interviews with finance directors. We're going to look at the power of your personal brand and how you can use that to advance your finance career, the skills and capabilities that you're going to need to set you apart from your peers, and what you can do to manage your career to achieve your full potential. So that dovetails in with what Karen was talking about just now. When I wrote Reach the Top in Finance, what inspired me to do it was I've met and interviewed so many senior leaders over the years in the finance professional, and I've always wondered what it must be like to hold that job where you're the CFO of a massive public company that employs tens of thousands of people around the world, and you've got all that pressure, all that responsibility on you. What sort of person do you need to be to hold that role? So that was really the question that I set out to ask myself when I wrote the book. And that also kind of led on to a secondary question, which is CFOs, are they born or are they made? Is being a CFO something that any of us can actually aspire to, or is it just the preserve of the few who happen to be born extremely talented? So that was one of the questions that I asked myself. And in order to answer those questions, I spoke to some leaders from all around the world, as I mentioned, from the FTSE 100, the Fortune 500. I also spoke to Geraldine Majette, who's CFO of Royal DSM, which is a very big company in the Netherlands. You can see I spoke to CFO of Bank of America, Rachel Campbell, the global head of people at KPMG International, and Julie Brown, who's got the CFO job of Burberry, which if I was a finance professional, I think would be about my dream job. So I got to speak to all those really interesting people who had a wide range of views on getting to the topic of finance, but also had some common thoughts on it as well. So we'll start off by having a look at personal brand. And here we have Ronan Dunn, who was the former CEO of Telefonica in the UK. He's now moved over to Verizon Wireless in the US. But he's a great person to interview because he actually came up through the finance function. He was CFO of Telefonica before he became CEO. So he knows what it's like to make that crucial jump from CFO to CEO, which is something that I do cover with him in a case study in my book. So let's have a stop for a minute and think about what our personal brand is. So our personal brand is really every way in which we come across to other people. So that's obviously the way we look, how we dress, what we say and how we speak, what we do, and also how our values are perceived by other people. All those things kind of make other people form an impression about us that actually can have a big bearing on how well we do in our careers. And you might think to yourself, well, you know, I'm a finance professional, why does personal brand matter to me? But it does matter a great deal because as a finance professional, you're trusted with something of great importance in today's world, which is obviously money. And so people want to have confidence in you because of the responsibility that you have. But actually, having a strong personal brand isn't just sort of the preserve of celebrities or CEOs or even journalists. It's actually the preserve of everyone, but particularly finance professionals as well. And that's why my first chapter in my book actually starts with personal brand. So we're all individuals, but finance leaders tend to have some common traits that I discovered during the process of interviewing them. And I wanted to go through them here with you so you can kind of get an idea of what sort of person you do need to be to get to the very top of the finance ladder. So integrity obviously came up as absolutely key, and that's for the obvious reason that you're being trusted with the organisation's money, and people expect the CFO to be honest. And at the very, very highest levels, when there's board meetings, often the investors will be watching the CFO's face while the CEO's giving a talk to say, okay, can we really trust what the CEO's saying here with this exciting strategy that they've got planned? And people will be trying to read the CFO's face because everyone's relying on the CFO to be the person who's the voice of reason, the voice of sense, the person who really knows whether a strategy is a good idea for the company or not. So transparency is also very important. People need to know that you are being honest and clear about what you're saying. And then we've got sound judgment. You need to be right more often than you are wrong. And this came from the CFO of Bank of America, this particular observation. And it's one of those ones where you think, oh, wow, that's easier said than done. How can you make sure you're right more often than you're wrong? But actually, there are ways you can increase your chances of being right, not least of all asking questions, which I'm going to come to later, making sure you build up your knowledge, making sure you found out the right people. But judgment should be something that throughout your career you're working on to hone. Analytics. You need to be analytical to get to the top in finance. It's no good just to be able to bring up burn up leads and needs and numbers. You do actually need to be able to look at them and identify what they mean. And in fact, this is even more important as we move into an age influenced by artificial intelligence and robotic process automation and all those things you might have been reading about in the newspapers. But actually, finance functions are going to be expected to make sense of all the data and patterns and everything that's going to be thrown at us. So being analytical is an important skill, and it's going to become even more important in future. A great manager and leader, in theory, that should really go without being said, but as a finance leader, you can be in charge of managing an awful lot of people, not all of whom will necessarily be from a finance background. To give you an idea, I pulled on a 3-year-old CFO of Bank of America. He actually managed effectively 4,000 people, which is, you know, the size of a company in its own right, so finance functions can be pretty massive. And authenticity, at the end of the day, we all need to be true to ourselves, and trying to be someone we're not usually results in us being found out in the end. So those are some of the key ingredients of a finance leader for you to think about. Marketing your brand then. So as your brand is a living, active thing, and in fact, you're actually having an impact on your brand every single day with every single thing you do. The most basic way in which you can influence your brand is obviously the tone of your emails, how you interact with other people, and then, of course, there's meetings and personal contact. So we all know that most of communication, I think 70% of communication, according to a University of Pennsylvania study, is done by body language. And then I think it's about 23% done on voice and inflection, and just 7% of communication is what you actually say. So when you think about that, when you actually go to a meeting, you need to kind of just bear in mind that that 7% is just what you actually say. So if you're looking quite bored in a meeting, but then you say some utterly brilliant things, that's not going to necessarily stand in good stead as if you actually look really interested and engaged in what some of the other people were saying. Now, obviously, we do live in this wonderful digital age that we're in, and actually that gives us a great opportunity to market our personal brands that previous generations didn't have. So there's a multitude of different platforms out there, and although we've got privacy settings and things, it's always a good idea to bear in mind whether you're posting anything that if your chief executive or senior partner accidentally came across, how would you feel about it? And something to think in mind as well, it's not just to sort of Facebook kind of thing, it's even if you post a review on a website or, you know, make a public complaint or something anywhere, anything just could be tracked back to you. It's always worth thinking, how would I feel if my chief executive or senior partner was to read that? But at the same time, forums do give you a great opportunity actually to build your personal brand, especially if you contribute to industry forums and share your knowledge if people are discussing a problem and you've encountered that particular problem. It's a great way, for example, if someone says, have you ever done a bond issue before? I haven't done that. You can share your advice if you have done a bond issue. It is actually a great way for you to build up your profile within the industry, because all sorts of people join into those forums. You can get external consultants and recruitment consultants and also people in other companies that will raise your profile to them. So use the internet to your advantage. LinkedIn, of course, is probably the most powerful marketing tool that you actually have. You want to keep that up to date. Make sure it highlights all your latest achievements. You also need to think about Google. What happens if somebody Googles you? It's always worth Googling yourself just to find out in case there's any nasty shocks. And as you progress in your career, you might want to invest in writing articles for the trade press, perhaps being interviewed by journalists, and also doing more public speaking. So that's something you can often do through your professional body's public speaking. But I know when I was editor of the Treasury magazine, we used to do a special supplement for Treasury Stars of the Future, and I was always amazed by the number of people that turned down the opportunity to appear in that, and that's kind of career goals. So make the most of the opportunities that you can actually get. Right, so let's go over to skills and capabilities next. And here we have Geraldine Massette, who's the CFO of Royal DSM, and she's gone up become a CFO through quite a technical route, financial controller route. And in my interviews with her in the book, she did talk about what a great, valuable role it is to be the financial controller. And that's on the subject of technical. Do you need to be a great technician to be a CFO? Yes, you do. Is being a great technician the only thing you need to be a great CFO? No, it isn't. So I talked to the finance leaders who I interviewed in my book about all the different attributes that you need to make it to the top in finance. And one thing that came over, perhaps quite surprisingly, was the importance of curiosity. That came over several times, and it's not necessarily what you might expect to be a real attribute, but actually, if you think about it, it makes quite a lot of sense that curiosity means you're reading around things, you're asking questions about things, you're wanting to know more, and all of those kind of things help you to build up a really broad knowledge base. That means when you are in the situation of having to make those key judgments that we talked about earlier, you actually have a really good foundation to draw on. So curiosity came up as something that was really important. The other thing they talked about, which is very fitting given the theme of what Carolyn was talking about earlier, is having a commitment to personal growth, so trying to push themselves further, learn new things. Sasha Romanovic, the CEO of Grant Thornton UK, she talked about how she had done training in neuro-linguistic programming, and so to develop her understanding of other people, but also commitment to growth in terms of a career point of view, of stretching themselves outside of their comfort zones, taking risks a bit, making sideways moves, not always going for upward moves, things that kind of made them more rounded as people. Influencing skills, this was another absolutely huge one, because as a CFO, you often have to influence decisions that are actually not effectively things that you're in control of. For example, you might have to try and influence the CEO who's got a marvelous idea about something, and you're like, oh, I don't really think the company can afford to do that. You might have to influence the sales and marketing team. You might have to influence external stakeholders, persuade the bank to lend you money. So influencing skills are really vital in a finance leader. Management skills, as you would expect, being a finance leader is a massive management job, whether you're in the field of practice. And then international experience. And that doesn't necessarily mean working abroad, although that can help quite a lot. International experience might also be just managing different teams that work across borders, but it is about gaining an understanding of how people work and do business within different cultures. So those are some of the attributes of a finance leader. And here we have Julie Brown, who I spoke to for a little bit, now CFO of Burberry. And she was a great person to speak to, actually. She had a really rich and varied career. She qualified as KPMG in accounting and tax, and her first role in industry was on the client side as an interim finance director, which was still at KPMG. And she really enjoyed, that was her first taste of industry, she really enjoyed it. So she decided she'd go to ICI, finance head for research and development, even though she had been offered the job as finance director on the place where she was going to Commonwealth. She turned down the opportunity to be finance director in exchange for being research and development finance head at ICI. And then she actually worked her way up through the company until she actually one day ended up as interim CFO of AstraZeneca while there was a bit of management reorganization going on. So that put her on the radar of headhunters, and she ended up becoming CFO at Smith & Nephew, a pharmaceutical company. And then earlier this year, she became Chief Operating Financial Officer of Burberry, and she also served as Audit Chair at Grace. So she has had an absolutely phenomenal career. And what can we learn for her? Well, one of the big learnings from Judy is she was prepared to be a small cog in a very large wheel. She thought ICI was going to be the best place she could learn about an industry, and that's why she joined it. And she was always very keen to broaden her experience base and learn from the best. And she felt the best was ICI, which is why she's there. She says that throughout her career, she's taken risks and seized opportunities, and she's actually held operational roles, actually, in South America as part of her career when she was at AstraZeneca. So she's done things that are really quite out of the comfort zone. She's embraced additional responsibility, and also she's always had a personal motto, they need to be the best that she can be. So those are the things that have helped her underpin Julie's success. Moving on to career management, which was obviously at the real heart of what Karen was talking about earlier. One of the things the finance leaders I spoke to, and this is very relevant for you, as I think a lot of people on this call are probably newly qualified, is that the first 10 years of your career are really important. So what you do with them really sets you up for later on. And the message that came through from the finance leaders that I spoke to is what you do and who you work for matter more than your job title. So don't get carried away with an inflated job title at this early part of your career. Really focus on building up your expertise and work for some interesting businesses. Also, to echo what Karen said, don't rush into an industry role immediately after you qualify unless you're really certain that's what you want. You can afford to take some time and have a look around and see what's out there. At the same time, however, don't wait too long, 10 to 15 years, for example, because you could find at that point you're competing with people who've got a lot more experience in the industry that you want to go into than you do have. Echoing again what Karen said earlier about not ruling out financial accountant roles, a lot of the people I talked to really felt that having had those strong technical roles under their belt in their career has really helped them to get to the top. So it's definitely worth considering those roles and actually doing them at an early stage rather than having to go back and fill in the gaps later on. And finally, take responsibility for your own career. So the fact that you're on this call today is great. You're already doing that because nobody else is actually going to do it for you. It's up to you to make things happen. We can't really carry on, I think, without having a little talk about our boss, because the fundamental fact is your boss can make or break your career. And this is perhaps a little unfortunate given that, according to a US poll, half of US adults have left a job to escape their manager. So it's not really very encouraging to think that that someone who's so fundamental to your career is disliked by so many, but that's the reality of the situation. So if you do have a manager you're not too keen on, the advice is try to have as constructive a relationship as possible, and if it's really not going well, just walk away and know that you've done your best to repair the relationship. So just try to do your best, but there's no shame in getting out if your boss really isn't working for you. Other advice I got from the finance leaders that I spoke to was the importance of working with your internal HR function, so they will know about internal opportunities that people could give to you, and also working with external functions, such as external advisors, such as recruitment consultants and headhunters. And one thing people repeatedly said, and I promise Karen hasn't put me up to this, is that it's really good to return the calls of recruitment consultants and headhunters, because even if you don't think you're looking for something right now, you might be surprised that what they have on offer, or you might want to take up a job offer that they might have later on. So keep in contact with them and build a relationship with them. And also internal sponsors, and Karen touched on mentoring earlier, but you do want to have people who can put in a good word for you if they are contacted by the HR team or by an external expert to find out a bit more about you. You want to have people who can actually say, yes, this is a great person and this is what they've done. So some of the main career hiccups are outlined here. You can do more about some of them than you can others. Taking the wrong job, the advice in this situation is just to move on probably as quickly as possible. If you do take the wrong job and you know it's the wrong job, but just try not to take the wrong job too often. Being passed over for promotion, which is a devastating thing when it happens, but it happens to a lot of people. And the key thing here is to learn from why you were passed over for promotion this time and try and develop the skills and experience that will prevent it happening again in the future. Company goes under, not much you can do about that unless it's down to your management of the finances. But what you can do is turn it to a positive in job interviews and show what you learned from the experience. Going viral on social media, well, I think we're going back to personal brand point here, is write your emails in such a way that doesn't happen to you. So here we've got a good example of someone who's had some ups and downs with finance, which is Ian Kenyon, now CFO of Cancer Research UK, which is the UK's biggest fundraising charity. Its revenue is over £600 million in the last financial year. You can see he's worked in corporates at Kingfish and Sainsbury's. He's also worked with Carpet White, an entrepreneurial business, and he had the honour of being with the best year H&B at the time he collapsed. And what we can learn from him is that it's important not to get trapped into comfort zones. He's always actively sought out new challenges and experiences. And also, the challenging times, for example, being at H&B, he's used those to kind of make him stronger. And he said he's being at H&B has never held him back in job interviews, but he's always emphasised what he's learned from it. And he's always had to answer questions about it, people are curious about what happened there. Influencing skills and picking your battles matter, especially when you're dealing with entrepreneurs. And he also made a point about maintaining a large and active network, staying in touch with former colleagues as you progress in your career. So today I've only had time to really touch on some of the things that I like about in the book, but I also explore a number of other themes, working with entrepreneurs, private equity, not-for-profit, being a woman in finance and how you can make that work, leading and managing the finance function, and then moving from CFO to CEO and building a non-executive portfolio career. And I also finished the book with a chapter on the accountant as an entrepreneur, which features an interview with Peter Hargreaves, founder of Hargreaves Lansdown, now worth over $3 billion, according to Forbes. So it's just good to show how far you can go in life with a good financial training behind you. And this is my book here, Meet the Top in Finance, published by Bloomsbury. As Karen said, there's a special offer available right now for client candidates of Hays. Just go to bloomsbury.com and you quote the code FINANCE to get a 30% discount. You have to quote that at the checkout. This offer is not available on Amazon. It's only available on Bloomsbury. And I've also started my own blog on getting to the top in finance. And there's an email newsletter that you can sign up to as well if you're interested in that, and the website for that is there. So thank you for your time, everyone. I'm now going to hand back over to Karen for the Q&A.
Great. Thank you, Sally. On that note, I'd like to thank you for attending today, and we'll now answer any questions, either for Sally or myself. I'm hoping that I've got the comms back on me. And Sally, are you still there as well? Just to double check.
Yes, I am.
Yes, great. Okay. So we've had a couple of questions. For start off, looks as if these are for both of us, Sally. So the first one is around whether there's any personal characteristics that we feel help people to achieve partner. Do you want me to start, or would you like to take a shot at that?
No, that's fine. You can start, Karen. That's fine.
Yeah. Okay. So, my view on that. I think that people who are aspiring to make partner in a professional services firm, well, one, they've got to be willing to make decisions. You've got to have genuine confidence in your own knowledge, but also know when you don't have some knowledge. I think the most important thing, well, aside from the ability to build strong relationships with all people, but particularly with clients, at the end of the day, it's a sales element role, I would say is someone who is positive and looks for solutions rather than just identifying problems. So I think those are sort of the personal characteristics or sort of competencies, if you like. I hope that answers the question. Sally, is there anything you'd add?
One of the things that came through to me to decide it is people talked about when you're in a partnership, it's obviously an environment that does operate a lot by influencing, and therefore you need to have the skills to be able to influence other people and convince them to come with you and follow your own journeys, and you've got to be able to sort of build up a bit of a sort of supporter base within the partnership. So I think that does come back as well to what you're saying with the relationship skills and the fact you have to build those skills with clients, but also building them up individually sort of within the firm as well.
Okay, thank you. I hope that answers your question. Another question here, I'm looking to undertake a qualification but not quite sure if to go for AAT or ACCA. So to the person that's asked that question, they're, for me personally, they're sort of two different qualifications, and it's obviously quite difficult not knowing what you've done so far in your career, maybe whether you're on this webinar and you've left school or you're about to leave university. For me, the AAT qualification is an excellent qualification, and it builds a firm basis on accounting through to trial balance and beyond. It's often seen as a route to then going to study for further qualifications, i.e. ACCA, ICAW, CEMA, for example. And in my career, I've often found people maybe have come through school, gone into an accountancy transactional role, studied and been supported to study for their AAT, really enjoyed that, done well, and at that point are kind of coming out at the level of a graduate with some exemptions from their professional qualifications, and a lot of the AAT qualified people then would potentially pick ACCA as a further qualification. So that's a my general answer to it. I'd be really happy to talk to you individually about that if you wanted to contact me directly, and my contact details will come up shortly. Sally, is that one for you? Or
no, I think
not.
I
really
think
no. Okay, no problem. All right, we've got another one here. What steps can one take to switch from not-for-profit career to private sector? Was there anyone in the case study, Sally, that had done that?
Yes, so Ian Kenyon had done that. He's moved from private sector, and he's now at Cancer Research UK. And one thing that I asked him about was how easy it was to move into not-for-profit and actually then go back in again as well to the private sector. And he actually said that he found it no problem at all, and that there was very easy, fluid movement each way. I mean, obviously, Cancer Research UK is a very big charity, So I guess with a charity of that sort of size, you know, you're probably used to dealing with some of the kind of same sort of issues you might be dealing with in a large corporate. But one thing he did say was that, you know, you do, it's not so much kind of your skills and expertise, because often those will be the same. It's actually your mindset is different. So when you move into not-for-profit, you know, it's not so much about bottom line. What it is making sure that you're supporting the organisation deliver value over the long term and money's used wisely. So obviously in Kent's 30K, you wanted to make sure the money's used wisely to solve, you know, to try and address cancer. And actually, you know, that is your fundamental role, is to make sure that it's enough money possible to kind of go over to the researchers. And it's a different mindset from the private sector. So it's not so much. So he found it pretty easy for people to move between the two, but you just got to kind of change your mindset about it.
Okay, thank you. My quick view on that, and I've seen plenty of people switch from not-for-profit and public services careers to private sector and vice versa. There are some external factors that can make it more or less challenging, and that depends on what's happening in the economy and quite simply, you know, what the supply and demand is like of skills within the marketplace. My advice to switch from not-for-profit to private sector would be try and find your like-for-like comparison. So if you're a not-for-profit in a small charity, look at the skill set you've got, and it's probably comparable to moving into a small to medium-sized enterprise in the private sector. Or if you were working in the NHS at the moment, then the sort of budgets and numbers you'd be handling would obviously be more similar to a corporate. And then you've got to look at the corporate values of those businesses and align, and always obviously stress your skills and competencies. We're now getting quite a few questions coming through, and we've got about 3 minutes left before we've obviously made a commitment to close the webinar. So can I just reassure anyone that's asked a question that our host, I'm sure, is rapidly trying to capture these, and that I'll come back to you, and I'm sure, Sally, you'd be delighted to add any comments back as well if we obviously capture all the questions. So I'll just pick maybe one more, which was one of the earlier ones that came through, because that's only fair. How's the best way to cover gaps in CV to enhance overall brand? So, Sally, any particular view on that?
Well, there is a view increasingly that actually gaps in CV, you know, we should be less hung up on those nowadays, because I think it might be perhaps contrary to something that we could say, but I think in terms of what you see as a gap, have a look at them hard, and are they a gap, or are they something that you can use to kind of promote your brand in other ways? For example, you know, if you went traveling, or you did voluntary work, or whatever it is, that actually kind of gives you a greater breadth as a person, that kind of you should be able to use to your advantage and not see as a disadvantage.
Okay, and I think my view on this is you're working in an accountancy and finance profession. You know, when we looked earlier at some of the characteristics that make a great leader in finance, and that kind of work ethic and integrity and honesty pieces, you've just got to be really honest about them. But if you've got gaps, that you've got clear reasons for leaving, that you can show that you've been doing something within that gap, and it's been building on your competencies in some way. There's a general theme of questions coming through, I think, from a number of you who are graduates who've been struggling a little bit to find your positions and make that, if you like, first step on your career. And if you think back to the CFO I mentioned who I'd met 15 years ago, he was working for free in a firm of chartered accountants in Essex in his first year of his accounting degree part-time just to get that experience on there. So consider obviously writing to people, offering to work for free, even part-time if you're still studying, you know, looking at voluntary work, anything that gets those practical skills onto the CV, I think would be key for me. And please don't rule out temporary work. It can be a great way to get those initial skills onto the CV as well. At Hayes, quite often we place a number of people into temporary positions who are graduates and undergraduates, and those organisations go on to recruit those individuals on a permanent basis, and off you go on that career path. So I'm really sorry we haven't been able to take all the questions. There's lots coming through, so we'll capture those. And I'm just about to now bring up a slide that has got my contact details on as your first point of contact. That's my email address on there, karen.young@hays.com. You can also find me easily on LinkedIn. If you type in Karen Young Hays, I should come up pretty easily. So please do not hesitate to contact me directly. As promised earlier in the presentation, there's the exclusive discount code. If you're interested in getting a copy of Sally's new book, and it's through the publisher's link, as Sally mentioned, and when you check out your basket, that's where you enter the code FINANCE. I'd like to thank you all for attending. I hope you found it useful. We have recorded the session, and this will become available. I'd like to extend my thanks once again to Sally. Thank you, Sally, for providing an excellent presentation. And with my recent copy of the book, I'm working my way through myself. I'm about 3/4 of the way through. I do recommend it. And you know, Sally's insight's invaluable, but it's because there's real people in there as well with their real stories. So do recommend it. And you can also see on there some of our social feeds, and they are worth following, actually. We've got Hays Future Finance Forum, which is a LinkedIn group aimed at part and newly qualified accountants. We've also got our Facebook group, if you prefer Facebook, with, again, I hope good content coming across for you. And, of course, if it's Twitter, we've got the hashtag Future of Finance at Hays News piece there as well. Finally, if I could just ask you to take a moment, as we close the webinar now, you will get a prompt to complete a really brief question or two that would automatically come up, and it would be really useful to then obviously get your feedback and of course contact me to know what other topics or deep dives into some of the things we've covered today you might be interested in for future webinars. So on behalf of Hays, thank you very much for joining, and I'll look forward to corresponding with some of you on your questions and giving you the answers, and thank you, Sally.
Thank you.
Thank you. Good afternoon. Bye-bye.